Please welcome my favorite coaching client, Linnaea Mallette.
Can you hear me? Good. Awesome. So, Craig.
Yes.
Fellow coaches. Rock stars. Are you having a good time?
Yes.
Yes. Learning a lot.
Yes.
Absolutely. Ready to take business and your lives to the next level. Yes? Well, I am here tonight to tell you, you can do it. Now, I want to get something out in the open right away so you're not sitting there wondering and pondering and being distracted. I sound the way I do because I'm German. That's not true. As Craig introduced me, I have a profound hearing loss. That means there are sounds I don't hear, and because I don't hear them, it's hard for me to pronounce them. So, what don't I hear? I do not hear the last octave of a piano. I've never heard a cricket. I don't hear birds. Well, I do hear crows, cranky seagulls, Big Bird on Sesame Street. I hear them. In terms of speech, I do not hear S's, T's, CH's. So sound comes at me in chunks, in blobs. That means at home, if my husband chooses to not suppress a burp or some other natural bodily functions, and I'm in the next room, it's not unusual for me to say, "What was that, honey?" Yes. So the way I hear, so how do I comprehend speech, is it's by the context of a conversation. It's like this. Suppose you're out here outside the hotel and somebody comes rushing up to you and they're talking to you and they have a very strong accent, really strong, and you're straining to try to get what they're saying, and you pick up the word Disneyland, and all of a sudden, presto, you understand about 90% of what they're saying. It's magical. We all use much more than just our ears to hear. How do I do the radio? I get that, you know, how can you be deaf and do the radio? Well, I do it carefully. I pick guests, most of the guests, 70% of them, 80, I know already. So I know that I'm going to be okay with them. I know their personality. I kind of know what they're going to say. For guests that I don't know, I get their book, I get their bio, I learn as much about them so that when they speak, I already have a content to attach it to. And of course, I have my good friend, Cersei Denyer, and I have the excellent Toganet staff right there, and I will say, "I didn't hear that. What was it?" And they'll say something back, you know, "Tell me, give me a few words so I'm back in contact." If you want to hear a show where I really did not hear, and I faked it most of the way through, it's when I had an extraordinary woman on my show named Michelle Sapu. She was killed by a drunk driver and miraculously was saved, her life was saved, but she has a very difficult time speaking. And I knew her from like 15 years ago, 20 years ago. You know Michelle Marcia? Yes. And I had forgotten, of course, I was seeing her then face to face so I could read her lips. I didn't remember that She was really difficult to understand. It's before I knew Susie, so there I was, faking 90% of what I hear. So I do that well. But generally, I try to pick guests that I'm going to understand, that I know. And that's how I pull off the radio show. What are some of the most common questions I get when people find out I'm hearing impaired? Do you hear anything? Yes, I do hear, I'm not totally deaf. Do you read lips? Absolutely. I love those lips. Do you know sign language? To which I say, in fact, I do. I would never really do that. I had an extraordinary, all of my guests on my radio show are extraordinary. But I had a gentleman named John Bauman. He calls himself the proud person with Parkinson's. I'm going to be a little bit like Glenn Morshower tonight. Is that okay? My brother was a photographer, 7 years older than me, and he always was taking pictures of me, and I was little, and I'd go, and he'd say, just shut up and smile. So ever since then, if there's a camera anywhere in my vicinity, you're going to see me shut up and smile. A little more cooperative than Adam Ace was last night. Anyhow, this gentleman, John Bauman, said that when people do not know how to interact with you, having a disability or something imperfect, they tend to overcompensate, but they have a good heart. And that's how I approach it as well. So, as a person with a disability, and having faced a lot of serious challenges. You see, another question that often comes my way is, well, how did you lose your hearing? How did you lose your hearing? When I was 4 years old, and we lived in San Fernando at the time in a big ranch. I had the chicken pox and the mumps, and what the other childhood disease, one right after another. Chickenpox, mumps, measles. One right after another. So this particular time, and I was only four, but it was one of those fully conscious times, you know, you're fully aware. I was laying on the sofa, Naugahyde sofa. Naugahyde. Remember, do they still make those things? They're terrible. They're fake leather, and they peel you off. So I'm laying on this Naugahyde sofa. My brother was kneeled towards my feet, kept pulling the covers over me because I was kicking them off. I was hot. My mom was by my head. She had her hand on my forehead, and she was looking at a mercury thermometer. How many of you remember mercury thermometers? Yeah. How many of you remember where those suckers went if you didn't put them in your mouth? Yeah. So my mom was peering at the thermometer, and I felt her hand tremble, and I heard the alarm in her voice. She said, your sister has a fever of 106 degrees. That is the temperature that burns off the high frequencies of hearing. Now I have people say, wow, then life is difficult for you. I said, well, yeah, there are some challenges to not hearing well, but oh, are there benefits? One of the best benefits is when I fly and there's a screaming kid in front of me or in back of me. Off the hearing aids. blessed quiet. The other big benefit is if I'm in an argument or a heated conversation, like with my husband, I just turn my back, and the conversation's over. One of the greatest benefits is being able to sit up close. Most organizations, including Craig, allow me to sit up close so I can read lips. And sometimes I really don't need to be close, but I can do okay kind of far back, but hey, why not take advantage? Well, one time this didn't work out like I had planned. President Clinton visited UCLA, Pauley Pavilion. I wanted to get up close and personal with this man. Not that personal. So I went to the lines, Pauley Pavilion. The lines were so long, it made the lines at Disneyland look puny. And there were guards, you know, up. So I kind of hobbled up, made sure my hearing aids were showing, had a really strong accent. I knew zip closed to read lips. No problem, I thought. So they escorted me up to the pigeon area, and I hear those birds too. Up with the pigeons, and here was the big screen so I could read President Clinton's lips. That is not what I had in mind. He was so far away and so small to really read his lips, you know, I had to have binoculars. So it doesn't always work, but I try my darnest to make that work for me. Hearing loss is a challenge. But to be honest with you, perfectly honest, I did not really recognize or embrace the amount of hearing loss I have until I was almost 45. My focus and my survival was my parents. How many people here had perfect parents? My mom, Catherine Bailey, lived to her last name, or her maiden name. She was an alcoholic till the day she died. My father, Loyal Thiven Lewis, came from a long history of chronic depression. I think I would have been depressed if I had a name like Loyal Thiven Lewis, too. They were such unhappy people that long before my brother and I were conceived, we were still, you know, twinkles in the ethers of the universe. My mom tried to talk my dad into doing a joint suicide. So that's kind of the emotional backdrop that I grew up in. Okay, so that was more my focus, surviving all of that. Now I will say also, I never thought of myself as having a disability until one day a college called and said, we are having a disability awareness week and we would love to have you come be our closing keynote. And I hesitated. Disability? I don't think of myself as having a disability. And I was really hesitant on accepting. Then they told me how much they want to pay me. Oh, I think I do have a disability. But like any good speaker, Maurice, I did my homework and I looked up disability awareness. And I was humbled and amazed at how it spoke to my experience that I had never articulated. And that is rejection, isolation, and frustration. Those tend to be the common theme among people who have disabilities. So, what I'd like to share with you are some tips, strategies, and insights that I have experienced, lived, read about, that really made a difference in the way I showed up in the world, that really enabled me to do it, to be here now, talking to you, successful, amazing people. So if it's all right with you, I'm going to share what I have found meaningful, because I have found in general, if it's meaningful to me, it's going to be meaningful to you. And if it's not, bite me. Number one, be willing to make mistakes. I was paralyzed half my life, or I should say a third of my life, paralyzed from starting anything because I couldn't handle making mistakes. Because if I made a mistake, I beat myself up terribly for weeks. I remember the day that changed. I was at a conference at UCLA. We were a satellite site, and the broadcast was from Texas. So it was the National Association of Female Executives. Did that still exist? Do we know? It may have gone away, called NAFI. Okay, so the then president wanted to have all attendees submit their favorite quotes. And she was going to pick the one or two that she felt were the best. Fast forward to the end of the day. She gets up and in the camera, you know, I'm seeing her virtually, and she's a very stunning, obviously professional woman. Just emanated confidence, professionalism, awesome. And she said, I was alarmed at the blood, sweat, and tears tone of all these quotes. She goes, so I want to tell you something that I attribute my success to. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
If it's worth doing, it's worth doing half-ass. The audience, I mean, there was a gasp and silence, but for me it was, yes! Because she just gave me permission to start, make mistakes. Because you know, you can't start something without making mistakes, right? You know that. It was, well, my life had never been the same since that. I love it. Once you start, or I have found, I'm speaking from my experience, once I was willing to make mistakes and embrace them, I was able to handle the ABCs of life a little better. What are the ABCs of life? Adversity, blunders, chaos. Adversity, blunders, chaos. Life's building blocks to build character and strength for us. Somebody once said that adversity was the diamond dust heaven used to polish its jewels. I love that. Isn't that great? And Larry Broughton, who's not here, he was here earlier today, very successful man, said on my radio show that the way to success is paved with mistakes. So that's, it's you. Mistakes, blunders, adversity, that, you know, if you think about it, they're so normal and natural. I think the problem with them is that we push against them. I think that's the real problem. Easier said than done, but acknowledging that the ABCs are normal, natural, nothing's gone wrong. Actually, things are really going quite right. ABCs of life. The next, take risk. Be willing to take risk. I think showing up here is a big risk, especially listening to Squirrely Craig for being willing to sit and listen to Squirrely Craig for 4 days. And risk getting overloaded with all that information. One of the biggest risks I took was to jump out of an airplane. Did this when I was about 26, 25. This was before tandem jumping. This was jumping out, me, my little body, with a ripcord, free falling for 5 seconds, and then the parachute opens. Now, 5 seconds, what a big deal, 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's a long time to be falling. And what's so interesting about that experience, that's kind of a side note, I had a walkie-talkie that was shattering stuff. No lips, no. I mean, no matter how good a walkie-talkie is, I don't hear it. I don't understand it. I had no idea if they were telling me that I should open my spare parachute because I felt I might be going down too fast. I chose to ignore it and not look like an idiot and open my spare parachute. Did you realize that I was willing to die? Then reveal that I had a hearing impairment. That's pretty huge, huh? Second risk, Toastmasters! The first meeting I went to was an open house. Santa Monica, huge crowd. There must have been 50 people in the room. Every walk of life, blind people, people in wheelchairs. I felt right at home. I had goosebumps. I just said, my God, this is what I was made for. I'm going to join. And I did. 8 years later. But thank God I joined. And I've been in the organization now over 20 years. What finally got me to join was the man I was dating at the time I thought was kind of jerky. It wasn't going to work out, so I thought, well, I'll kill two birds with one stone and join a singles Toastmasters club. But as it turns out, he ended up being my husband. But let me tell you that story because that is a risk, huge risk that I had taken as well. I had just broken up with a young stud, 10 years younger than me, great, great fun, but it was a Guns N' Roses type of relationship. Drugs, alcohol, and lots of other things. So obviously it wasn't going to work. And when he broke up with me, I really had no idea what I was going to do now. Now what? So I thought, well, what's one thing you've always wanted to do? Just something. And I thought, well, I've always wanted to study classical music. And that's really an about face from what I was had with Ron. So I pinned classical music on that stuff and focused on that. Within a few days, my mom came to me and said, look, there's a local orchestra. Opened up its doors to volunteers. Perfect timing. Don't you love that perfect timing? So I volunteered. I had so much fun. I would greet people coming in. I would run the flowers or the wine to the solo performers. And I got to go to the parties after the concerts. The conductor's mom would have parties at her house, and all the musicians would go there. It was great fun. And after about a year, there's this man, I guess he'd been a boy then, but anyhow, young person, handsome, sitting in the violin section. And there's something about him, you know how that is? When it's meant to be, it twinkles, there's something about it you can't ignore. So I want this guy to approach me. So I did everything for 3 months to get his attention. I had long, bouncy blonde hair and was much thinner, and I would just kind of ignored me. I would wear red, ignored me. I'd wear short dresses, lot of legs, ignored me. Until one night at these parties, he was there. He had never been there before. As luck would have it, he was talking to somebody I know, Brian. So I walked over. And Brian sized me up like I was a side dish he didn't order, and I ignored him. and look at this gentleman I've been trying to meet for 3 months. And I almost died. Not only was he drop dead gorgeous in a tuxedo, women, right, men? Any man in a tuxedo is drop dead gorgeous. They just are. He had green eyes. And I didn't know what to do. I looked over at Brian saying, you know, how about some introduction? So he introduced us. Linnaea, this is Bruce. Bruce, this is Linnaea. And then he did the unthinkable. He turned to walk away. Thanks, Brian. So Bruce turned to walk away too. I reached out and touched him. And I said, Bruce, I've been wanting to talk to you for 3 months. I finally got his attention. I said, but as he's laying it out, I am hearing impaired, and I'm not going to be able to hear you in the living room. Do you mind talking to me in the kitchen? He said, no problem. We talked for 2 hours in the kitchen, went out 2 weeks later, and July 11th will be 25 years that we have been together. In this day and age, and with me a diehard flirt, that is nothing to sneeze at. Finally, giving the benefit of the doubt. This is more, obviously, more of an attitude than it is. All the other things I've talked about have been more of action. Giving the benefit of the doubt has been a huge thing. A huge way of approaching those ornery toads in my life. And I love it because it's a nice balance between forgiveness, when forgiveness is asking a little much, and a grudge, which doesn't feel good. It doesn't do anybody any good. My first big encounter with giving the benefit of the doubt, my first job, this gentleman named Sonny, we were wonderful friends, but it didn't start out that way. I used to walk down the hall, and then I didn't even wear hearing aids because it took a long time for technology to be able to create something that amplifies what I don't hear and leave alone what I do hear. I do hear low tones normally, so I didn't have hearing aids. So I'm walking down the hall, and Sonny would be talking to me, and I would ignore him. I didn't hear him. So he figured I was a racist because he was colored. So he copped a real nasty attitude. I figured he had a nasty attitude because I was imperfect. We had a good laugh when we discovered what was going on here, but the underlying wisdom in this is how often we project onto others our own issues. It's not interesting. Very interesting. Another example, another huge awareness of the importance of the benefit of the doubt is when we're driving. I was out in the emergency hospital. I had my mom hauled in because I had to rescue her from being on the floor in her house, wrapped up in a phone cord. My dad had Alzheimer's at that time. He's just standing there saying, I want some stamps. I want some stamps. The stuff of nightmares. Anyhow, so the doctors came up and said, your parents can no longer live alone. They just can't. And I was so distressed. It's not good news. And I knew they wanted to die in that house that they've lived in since 1959. I drove. It was the only way I could get a sense of control over this uncontrollable situation. All of a sudden, I hear this, aah! Somebody whips around me and kind of, and I was devastated. And I thought, I realized I was driving around kind of slow and aimlessly. And I thought, man, if they only knew what I was going through, they wouldn't have done that. So unless I'm in a big hurry, and you know, when I'm in a big hurry, anybody who drives too fast is insane, and anybody who drives too slow is a moron. I really give drivers the benefit of the doubt. You have no idea what's going on. They could be in pain. They could have just lost their spouse or boyfriend or just broken up with them. Their pet could have just been put to sleep. God, because those ABCs are active all the time in everybody's life. Everybody's got them, right? The most profound experience for me in extending the benefit of the doubt was not too long ago. There was a woman that worked on my floor at UCLA. We were not in the same organization, but we were in the same floor. And by nature of the fact that I was a training coordinator and she would do training, sometimes we'd be in the same meeting together. This woman was tall, gorgeous, blonde hair, circled in high society because her husband was an assistant to an assemblyman, and she was a snot. She was a snot. People behind her back would say she's a prima donna. And she especially did things to make my life miserable. I don't want to take the time to explain it. It had to do with throwing me out of a meeting room right after a Toastmasters meeting. You know how you want to sit and mingle, and she just, I have a meeting. So I had issues, real issues with this woman, and I really wanted to hate her, and I wanted to do things to make her life miserable. And then I reminded myself, you know, Linnaea, generally, when people behave that way, they're not happy and something's going on. So why don't you just give her the benefit of the doubt? She's probably a nice person. She's probably got stuff going on. It has nothing to do with you. Fast forward a couple of years. It's a Monday morning, and I'm in the ladies' room at work, and a colleague comes in, and she's crying. And she grabs my hands, and she says, "Did you hear what happened to Kim? Did you hear?" I said, "God, oh, what? What happened?" Her husband shot her dead and then shot himself. The Baldwin Hills suicide, murder and suicide. I was crushed. I thought, my God. She had been living, I found out, with a very depressed man with a disease that got worse and worse for 30 years. She didn't need me adding to the struggles that she was already trying to handle. And it felt bad to have heard the news, but I was grateful it didn't hurt even more so by my being a jerk with her, because I was not. There's a woman on my radio show not long ago, and I encourage you to listen to this one. Carrie Bosca. Carrie Bosca. Gorgeous blonde. Look at her, you think she's got the world by the tail. Between a Friday morning and a Monday morning, this is what happened. On a Friday morning, she and her husband are playfully joking around about their Great Dane slobbering on their bed. Friday afternoon, her parents confront her. He's stealing money from the family business, and they confront him about it. He decides not to come home. He's gone. She starts to look on the computer to get a clue where he is. She finds out he's a drug addict and a sex addict, has been meeting people in hotels for years, doing drugs for years. On Monday morning, her father came to tell her he had killed himself. Carrie had a 6-month-old infant daughter and a 7-year-old son. What a hell of a thing to happen in 4 days. Now, do you imagine Carrie might not hear you if she was walking down the hall and you said something to her? Do you think she might be driving a little aimlessly? Do you think she might not be super happy and friendly with you? We never know what's going on in another person's life. It's a great gift to give the benefit of the doubt. What I'd like to sum up with is one of my all-time favorite stories. It's my favorite story because it has a cat in it. Do we have a cat in here? Yeah. Cats are so much better than dogs. This story beautifully sums up what I've just talked about. Two old maids. Now, this is a setting in the 50s. We really don't have old maids in this day and age. I mean, 80 is still young. It's miraculous. I love it. But this is two old maids in the 50s. You know, the flowered dress, and the down to here, and the gaudy, big, cloddy shoes. Mita and Iva. Iva was a cute little button. She had had a lover once, but he broke her heart, and that was the end of that for her. Mita was not a pretty button, never had any love life, and so the two of them just decided they were going to shut out the world and live in their little house in Topeka, Kansas, with their cat named Princess. They rarely ventured out. They didn't trust anybody, gave nobody the benefit of the doubt, didn't want to have anything to do with the ABCs of life. I mean, they did everything they could to protect themselves and Princess. But one day, there was an article in the newspaper about the town starting a gardening club. Iva loved gardening. She decided to go. Mita was fit to be tied. You know that's not going to be good for you. You know there are weird, greedy people out there. You're going to regret this. Don't go. Iva went. Iva had a blast. And not only that, there was a cute old fight to caught her eye. Mita was beside herself. You've had your heart broken once before. You don't want to do this again. I'm warning you. You're making a mistake. They fell in love, Iva and this cute old fart. And the cute old fart decided to take a cruise around the world and take Iva with him. Mita said, that's it. You go out that door with this man, and you are never stepping foot in this house again. So Iva sadly took her bags, loaded them up in the taxi, looked back and saw the drapes closed. So Mita lived with Princess, dreaming of the day when Iva would come crawling back on her knees. And Mita would get to say, it wasn't until a year later a letter came. It was Iva's writing. She grabbed Princess, went in the kitchen, sat down at the table. She's trembling. The moment she'd been waiting for it. She opens it, and it's just one page, one sentence. It said, Mita, let the cat out. So, what's the moral of the story? Let the cat out. Take risk. Be willing to become great by making lots and lots of mistakes. Give others the benefit of the doubt. Give yourself the benefit of the doubt. I found it's nice to give life the benefit of the doubt because you got to admit sometimes things don't look so perfect on the outside. But I promise you, on the inside, life is creating something perfect just for you. So Craig, fellow coaches, rock stars, whatever dream you've pinned on that star, whatever it is you want to do, read my lips, friends. If I can do it, you can do it too.